It's time for the movie raid, and tonight's victim is Molly Hagan, actress that played in countless films and television, such as I, Zombie, based off the comic book, and The Dentist, and The Lucky Ones, and Code of Silence, amongst others. Hello.
Hello.
So tell us about the I, Zombie.
It's a series for the CW, and I think the premiere is in January, or it's definitely in 2015. It has not started airing, and they just started filming them, and it stars Rose McIver, who is just such a pleasure. She's funny, and she's gorgeous, and the series is funny and interesting, and even if I wasn't in it, I'd be watching it, because it's totally my cup of tea. It's very funny.
What do you play as?
I play Rose's mom, and I'm sort of labeled as a tiger mother, which a tiger mother is a mother who's very hell-bent on her children succeeding, and so they raise them in a very specific fashion. Overbearing, all I care about is her success. When growing up, I'm sure I didn't give her a lot of leeway in terms of play. The play was probably really structured. It's more about raising kids to succeed rather than raising kids to be lovable.
But between film and television, is it actually more challenging as far as role goes?
Well, television works a lot faster than film. Like, if you're in a series, you have time to develop your character and do things, because you're going to be going to work every day. But if you just show up for a day or a 1 week on a show, that's hard. You have to hit it, quit it, and forget it. There's no time for development of whatever you got going. Whereas if you're a regular on a series, you know, you can sort of, it sort of develops. And not that each episode you take your time, but you can sort of take your time. It morphs, it changes, it grows, it becomes something more than what you started with, like on the first shoot. Film takes longer, generally, but actually the films that I do don't take longer. They work really fast. So I don't think one's more difficult than the other. They're just different.
Yeah, in terms of role, like you mentioned, it's always about the time, because when it comes to film, you do have time to build up whatever your character is. You have time to figure out what he or she is all about. It is short. You can just you take like 1 day, and then you have to kind of remember what exactly you're trying to portray as.
Right.
It does become very difficult. I can see that happening. And it does actually show on series. It's just that's the problem. It can be hard to even get into character after so many days of short time.
Well, you can really see, like, a pilot versus something that's, you know, even 10 episodes in. All of a sudden, you know, the writers know the actors more. They start writing for the actors. The actors understand what, you know, their character more. And even though pilots can be really good, if they're allowed to really live, then you see real things come together and just the depth of the stuff that's going on. I mean, the Sopranos pilot wasn't what ended up, do you know what I mean? I mean, over time, it just becomes so much more richer.
Yeah, and it's just, when it comes to that, it's like a big test run. Even if the show has been around, let's say, a full season, it's still considered as a test run, because they're still trying to test out which characters is best for which character. They're trying to test out which one's better for the audience in terms of story.
Right, be most interested in, or, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah,
that's the biggest. It's all about popularity when it comes to television wise. If you can do it on TV series wise, if you can make that character just pop out of all the other characters, it's always about what the audience is gonna vote upon. But when it comes to film, it's usually about critics. The most regular critics is the more professional ones.
There are a lot of test screenings of film. A lot.
Oh yeah.
Test screenings of TV shows too, so they'll go in and they'll change things no matter how small the budget is. They'll go in and change things.
Oh, definitely. It's a constant thing. You mean it's like with script wise, it's like you'll get a script from, let's say, 5 minutes, but then you'll get another script of the same script but different within another 10 minutes later. But in terms of drama,
the scripts that change the greatest are sitcoms. Those will change rapidly. But other things don't change quite as much as sitcoms do.
Yeah, because once it hits, it usually stays that way for quite a while, unless, you know, until either the audience gets tired of seeing it, or the writers and or producers, you know, have a hand in and say, oh, well, it doesn't work very well, let's just change it up.
Well, I mean, you can usually, even though you might be rehearsing a sitcom, the next day you might get a completely different script.
Oh yeah.
Before it shoots.
Definitely.
So you, for sitcom, you have like 4 days or two to three days of rehearsal, and then you shoot. Some of it shoots in front of a live audience. Some of it's block and shoot, but the stuff can change on a dime. And even while you're shooting it, if it's a block and shoot or block and tape or whatever you want to call it, it can change. You can do a take, and then it can change before the next take.
Oh yeah. But compared to film and television, do you think the drama has more elevation in TV compared to the film?
I will say this, I think TV's never been better. I mean, I think a lot of the dramas on TV right now are extraordinary, and because it's a long form as opposed to a shorter form like film, it can be much richer. I mean, Breaking Bad was such a rich experience because it was a long form. You could not have done what you did in Breaking Bad in a film because of the time.
Do you think there should be a balance when it comes to emotion in the character?
A balance in the emotion of a character?
Yeah.
I think the first and foremost is a story, and then if something emotional happens because of story, I mean, the way I've been trained, it's not necessarily about the emotions, it's about story.
Yeah.
And about serving circumstances. And if serving circumstances produce an emotion, then it produces emotion. If it doesn't, then it doesn't. But I think story should always lead.
Do you think sex appeal is a part of getting ready for the roles?
I'm 53, no. Even when I was young, I was a character actress, so it doesn't really apply to me. I think some people inherently are sexy and are beautiful in a sort of a sexual way. I don't know if you can cultivate that. I think you either have it or you don't. I kind of feel that way about comedy, too. You either have it or you don't. I guess somewhat it can be cultivated, but sex appeal is, I really think, something you grow into in your teens and you sort of develop. I think you either have it or you don't. I mean, so for me, no, I don't think sex appeal is important because I'm never going to be cast in those roles.
Yeah, there are actors that specifically go for it. There's always different categories of actors. Like, there's the creepy character, there's the standalone character, and then, of course, the sex appeal character, like, more importantly, the image to the character, like the ripped abs and for females, beautiful body, hair, and all that. But do you think it's kind of a little bit of a distraction in a way?
A distraction?
Yeah.
No, I mean, when I'm watching, this is such a complicated thing because I'm a fan. I'm a fan. So when I understand I want to watch something and I want to see beautiful people. I want to see beautiful people. On the other hand, I really want to see regular looking people too. I want to see character faces and character stuff. But if, like, Keira Knightley, she's extraordinary looking. I like looking at her in a film because she's extraordinary looking to me. So I like watching her. Julia Louis-Dreyfus, I think Julia is beautiful. I like watching her because she's beautiful. I mean, she's also really funny, but I mean, it doesn't hurt that these people are gorgeous. And so I don't necessarily think it's a distraction. I think it can enhance. And at the same point, it would be nice to see normal looking people on TV and film.
Yeah, it's like when you watch commercials, infomercials, or whatever commercials that's on, you always see more of an attractive person on there because that's part of the whole selling point. When it comes to products, it's the same thing with film and television. You don't see someone that's fat half the time on a commercial. You don't see anyone that's like too skinny or less attractive compared to this other attractive person.
Yeah, I think commercials are about hiring people who look like the better side of normal. You know, I mean, they're unless it's a specific, you know, they have to be a knockout. But if it's, you know, a bank commercial or something like that, they're going to pick people who, in the Midwest, they'd be gorgeous, but in Hollywood, they're, you know, normal looking. Average. In Hollywood, they'd be average. Somewhere else, they'd be fantastic looking in real life, but in Hollywood, they would be average. The most average and normal looking we get, I think, is probably in commercials.
Yeah, it's all about product placement.
Well, it's also about appealing to people, like someone watching TV and going, oh, I recognize myself as that, and so I'm going to buy that product.
It's all about how you sell it.
Yep.
What are your thoughts? Films and television are going to the traditional icons of horror, icons of film, by focusing on like zombies, like this and Dracula, because you see more films of this than you do, like, you know, serial killers, unless it's a, you know, criminal TV show.
Well, I think, you know, if it's zombies, if it's vampires, if it's things like that, I think that puts it in the realm of fantasy, and it can be a good scare, because I don't think we actually believe it, but serial killers and things like that, they are out there. That's really hard for, I can't watch that stuff. I can watch stuff that I know is fantastical, but I, just by virtue of how many programs are on about that kind of stuff, I guess others do too. I don't know how much we like to, as a nation, really delve into real stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to watch a psychotic killer. I just don't. It scares the hell out of me. I don't like watching sociopaths. I don't like, it's a great movie, won the Academy Award, but it was terrifying to me. Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah, that's what I was
thinking. That was just, it was brutal. It was absolutely brutal. And I'm not watching The Cult of Hannibal.
Yeah, that would be the prequel to Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah, I'm not watching that. It might be great, but I can't.
Well, go ahead and plug in about iZombie and your other current projects that you're doing. When can we expect this? Also named, where's it going to be airing? Is it only going to be airing on this station or on this channel?
Yeah, you know, I have DirecTV. I thought I was going to get it. I think so. The CW, I think that's who's going to, you know, maybe DirecTV has local programming or something, and maybe it's actually on some sort of local programming in California or Los Angeles, but I don't know. I just did an episode of Satisfaction, which is a USA show, which is very interesting. I think it's interesting. I'm gonna shoot Zac Efron's film this Friday, so things are going okay.
Awesome. Well, there you have it, everybody. Actress Molly Hagan.